Malade to the Oscar red carpet. She didn't pass go, and she didn't collect 200. Instead, she just catapulted to international stardom. She is India's first bona fide Hollywood star, and I am thrilled to meet her. Straight from Los Angeles, Frida Pinto, you are India's most desirable. Well,
thank you.
Frida, you are living a million girls' dream. And I have to confess to you, you're also living my dream.
Am I?
I dreamt all this for myself when I was growing up. And I can't imagine a person more deserving who could have carried it off as well as you have. My dream.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
It is 2 years now. I mean, has the euphoria lessened a little bit? Is it more routine?
Yeah, I think what happened in 2008 and the beginning of 2009 was all too fast, and it all happened at lightning speed. Now I feel it's kind of a little more settled. I wouldn't say it has stopped, and I would never wish for it to stop.
I would never wish for it to stop either.
Thank you. The euphoria has settled, but it hasn't disappeared. It's still there.
You know, to many people, this story of yours, it's like a fairy tale. Girl from small town makes it so big in Hollywood.
Yeah.
I find a lot of people just turn around and say, oh, Frida really got lucky. Was it all luck?
Well, I will say everybody needs that little ray of luck in order to take them to the next step. I had no godfather. I had no connections.
So you went on to modeling?
So I went on to modeling because I needed pocket money. I mean, sure, everybody needs
everybody
pocket money.
Everybody does.
Yeah.
So was it tough getting modeling. A break in modeling?
It was difficult. Even I think the modeling industry is so competitive and so tough.
Yeah.
It's tough.
Is there a rejection?
A lot of rejection. I got rejected a million times.
Don't tell me.
Doesn't look Indian. Looks too Indian. So there you go. Two contradictory things. Some people said, too skinny. Not too tall. And some people said, doesn't have, screen presence. Okay, I took that as well.
But you see, Frida, in show business, the difficult part is, it's not that you're putting out a product. We're putting out ourselves.
Yes.
So if that is rejected, it's a very personal thing.
We're human beings and we all want to be appreciated. We all want to be loved. I remember having a little breakdown when I was 23 and I was telling my sister, I haven't done anything in life that I wanted to do, that I pictured myself doing at 19, you know?
So there were about 5 or 6 or 7 years of frustration.
Yeah, because unfortunately I was fixated only on one thing, and that was acting, and it was not happening.
But it did happen.
It did happen.
Some dog happened.
And I found my first audition to be so freeing in a way, that I was finally doing something that I wanted to do, even though I wasn't given the part.
So how shocked were you when the same film reached the pinnacle of cinema?
Is just one of the most phenomenal experiences. Even if I just had one line in that film, to just say that I was part of that film means a lot to me. But it was only after a year, you know, that I really understood that, oh my God, I just did an Oscar-winning film.
But you know, when for most actors, when their first film wins an Oscar, it's when victory and vindication collide.
Yeah.
All the hard work, all the years of struggle.
You're completely vindicated in a way.
Did you feel that?
I felt an intense feeling of, I wouldn't go up to the extent of saying that that was it. You know, I'm not, it's vindication. I don't have to work any harder. I guess it's victory would be more the right word to use. I'd keep vindication aside for now.
You worked with the director who I absolutely adore, Woody Allen.
Oh, yay. Love him.
What did he say to you? How did you interact?
It was the most relaxed audition ever. And there was no camera rolling. It was just Woody sitting like this close to my face. I'm not going to imitate him right now because my voice
Do
is
Do imitate really... him. I would love to
know. No, he just has these very, so, you know, there's this boy who's living across the road and...
He's shy.
He's very shy. And he keeps saying this thing with his fingers. It's very cute, very adorable.
I'm sure.
And 3 days later, I was in L.A., literally the day before the Oscars, and I heard that I got the part.
What a coup.
So I got two gifts, actually. I knew I was going to be part of Miral, which was Julian Schnabel's film, and Woody Allen.
In a matter of weeks, Frida moved into the higher echelons of Hollywood. She was dining with Cher and Kurt Russell, patting John Stewart's shoulder, and socializing with Brangelina, Meryl Streep, Sharon Stone, and what have you. Were you starstruck in the beginning?
Very. Very starstruck. I had to really train myself to be calm and composed if at all I saw Angelina Jolie, you know, walking down somewhere. It is difficult because it's like living in a fairy tale. It's like Alice in Wonderland, you know. I never thought I'd ever meet Mick Jagger.
What did you say when you met him?
I didn't say anything. See, this is the thing. I don't know what to say. I just get very nervous. And I just said, I love your music. And that's about it.
You know, you and Dave Patel are the only two people who can understand the life changes that have come with Slumdog.
Absolutely.
Do you ever sit and marvel at how far you've come?
We do. And we still talk about it. And I think it was easier for me to kind of grapple with reality because he was in it with me. So he knew the euphoria was experienced by both of us equally. I feel, in a way, we helped each other come back to reality. That's why I sometimes say, he's like my best friend.
And it's like you graduated together.
Yeah.
Like bond.
We have too many memories together in terms of, you know, going to award ceremonies, you know, little stories here and there, which only the two of us know and giggle at, and people don't even find it funny, but it's just our story.
You know, I've never met him.
You haven't?
No. What's he like as a person? I believe he's very funny.
He's extremely funny. He's got an amazing sense of humor. Sometimes it takes me like a minute. He thinks I'm not laughing at his joke, but it's only because I'm processing his joke in my head. I'm like, what? Oh, okay.
But you know, Anil Kapoor said that he sensed magical chemistry between the two of you during Slumdog. Was it during or after?
I guess we were not, if it happened while the film was being made, we were not completely aware of it.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. Or rather didn't want to address it because you don't know whether it's the film doing it or if it's the real people that we are that is creating the magic. So we didn't talk about it at all. And just a hint, but not really say, I think I'm attracted to you. Or I think I'm developing feelings for you. It was never that blatant. If Anil Kapoor actually experienced, kind of witnessed it, witnessed what we were experiencing, I must say that he is a genius. But he shouldn't have said it before we said it.
But you never said it.
I know, but he should have given us some time.
You can say it now, for the record.
No, I mean, I was like, I'm just on this red carpet, and all of a sudden he's talking to Ryan Seacrest, and he's saying things that is completely embarrassing me. I'm like, oh my God, what is happening? Where do I look? And yeah.
But by then it had happened.
Yeah, it had, but we hadn't spoken to anybody about it.
So you actually kept it hidden on the set, even from Danny and everybody?
I don't know. Danny must have been super perceptive as well. But he said he did not know what was happening either, because when he was asked, he was like, oh, maybe he's just lying. I don't know. I don't think we spoke to anybody about it, except maybe my sister.
You both work so hard. You travel so hard. I mean, he's somewhere else. You're somewhere else.
Okay, I have this film schedule. I have 2 weeks in between where I'm not doing much. Why don't you come down to where I am? And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, you know, and we just try to accept it. We like BBM each other and send voice notes, I guess. Little things that you can do. It's long distance in a way, but it's quite kind of okay in a way as well, because you go away for a while and you come back with so many things that you want to talk about, so many things that you want to do together. You want to go and explore this new, say, a new city and new country, and you do it together because you're that much more excited to do it.
But, you know, I also feel that romance at a distance becomes far more, you know, powerful.
There's a lot more suspense in it.
Yes.
Okay. So her hair's grown longer. Has she cut her hair? Like simple things like that to how much you've changed.
That's true. I have to tell you, like all top Hollywood stars, Frida travels with an entourage, stays in presidential suites, is pursued by the paparazzi, and designers offer her the sun and the moon to wear their best jewels and outfits. But Frida, with modest beginnings, and now with this glamorous lifestyle, has your relationship with money changed?
I value it more now.
But you must have valued it a lot then.
I did, but I never really had that much money, so I did not know what to talk about then.
You must be a little millionaire-ess now.
No, I'm not.
Not yet?
Not yet. So in 10 years.
10 years, okay. Are there ever any moments, you know, of self-doubt or fears or anything?
Oh, a lot of fears. I would say there's less insecurity, but there's definitely fear of being toppled over, you know? And there's no security in my job as such, you know, because I never know what I'm going to do next. But it can be a little nerve-wracking because you're thinking, am I going to ever work again?
That's right.
like I said, toppled over, not being accepted in the film industry anymore. Like, you know, oh, we've had enough of that Indian girl.
So do you ever think, what if Slumdog hadn't happened?
I would have known another life and wouldn't have known this one, which is my ultimate dream. But I feel the kind of person that I am, I would try and find satisfaction in that as well, because I don't want to live unhappy.
No, we don't want you to live unhappy. But Slumdog happened, and God sprinkled her with stardust. But how did her family deal with the new international Frida? We'll find out in a few minutes, so come back. But you must have also been hugely popular with the boys.
I wouldn't say I got a lot of attention, but I did get a little.
I would love listening to Frida's stories from college. She loves her slight flirting and she loves hanging out with the guys. So,
I mean, it's
totally
just
goes wrong move. Not defending myself. I loved it.
Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena Ultra Sheer. Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena Ultra Sheer.
Ask Woody Allen. He says, Frida is the perfect object of desire. She's exactly what I wish to see when I look out of my window in Manhattan. And I have her in front of me. But I am going to take her back to her room. Malad.
Okay.
Your dad's a bank manager.
Was a bank manager. He's retired now.
He's retired. Yeah. Mom?
Mom was a school teacher and I was the headmistress of a school. She's a principal.
So your credentials are finance and education.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Neither of which I was completely interested in. Over my head.
If you had an uncle in Bollywood.
I prefer that.
Would have been perfect. Life would have been easy. Tell me a little bit, what was life like for you growing up?
I was very dramatic as a child. Everything had to be the extremes. There was never middle ground. So if I'm crying, I have to be bawling. If I was sad, I had to be depressed, you know? So
I wanted to find out who you are behind this smokescreen of glamour.
Okay.
I spoke to somebody who's very close to you.
Okay.
I'd like to introduce you to Frida's sister and best friend, Sharon Pinto. I asked Sharon what you're like at home, and this is what she said.
She's a mad girl. She makes up her own songs. She'll make my dad dance with her. My dad's not very young, but she'll still get him to stand up and say, come dad, let's dance. And you know, she'd be singing a stupid tune that she just came up with and they'd be dancing. Or she'd make these funny sounds and baby faces and, you know, weird expressions. And even if you're pissed off, you'll start laughing. So that's how Frida is at home. You know, she's a little crazy, sweet. You get a little annoyed because she's like Monica from Friends, absolutely spick and span. But it's good. I mean, I love having my sister around me.
So all the singing and dancing and making dad dance, I mean, the family must have said, Frida is surely going to be a star, didn't they?
In a way, I think my mum, more than my dad, saw it coming. I wouldn't say a star, but I would say just an actor. A working actor.
You start preparing in some way?
Yeah. I never went to an acting school. I just went out there just watching films, reading up stuff about people, actors. You just you know, autobiographical stuff.
I think you did other things too.
Like?
Uh-oh.
What did my sister tell you?
Preparing for the future. Do you want to watch?
Okay.
You know what? Frida loves standing in front of the mirror and you know, pretending she was receiving the Oscar and asking herself questions and answering them. It's funny because one day she was doing that and she was standing in front of the mirror happened to walk in. And Frida was really embarrassed and, you know, she was like, why did you come in? And I'm like, you know, I was just laughing. It was funny. But she's practiced her Oscar speeches and she's received awards and, you know, given her thank you speeches all in front of the mirror, even before all of this happened.
So embarrassing.
That is the power of dreams.
Yeah.
And I want you to remember, everything you imagine is possible. It's out there. All you have to do is go and get it. She imagined it and she made it happen, right? What did you say in all the speeches?
I am not telling you because this is so absolutely embarrassing.
What did you say at home? Do you want to take that as a mic?
No, I didn't. Can I take that as a golden statue?
Yes. This is little Frida, huh?
Okay, little Frida. I want to thank my mum, my dad, my sister. And I would like to thank Steven Spielberg for giving me my first ever job.
How did you feel the first time when you saw yourself in Slumdog?
The first time I watched the film was with the live audience at the Toronto Film Festival.
Okay.
And the first scene happens and my face is blown up 10 times 10 because it's like, it's a massive screen, right? And immediately I was like, oh, don't want to see that. Because it's finally when the credits rolled out and I saw my name, you know, come third in credit. I just intense moment of pride and gratitude for what I had received.
Okay. Do you want to know what Sharon felt when she first saw your film?
Okay.
It's just very, very touching and emotional to see your little sister, who is not so little anymore, and, you know, be on big screen, and you believe that she's, you know, born to do something good and big. And when you actually see her on big screen, that's just beautiful. I actually had tears in my eyes, but I think my tears were more because I was so happy to see my sister there and so proud of her.
I really wonder, did your family ever tell you what it meant to them to see you at the Oscar red carpet?
I think my family likes to play it very normal, or like they like to pretend to be very normal, only because that grounds me and they know that, you know, so I wouldn't want it any other way.
You know, the thing is, we'd been for the BAFTA Awards when we were with Frida. I was there, my mom was there. And for me, honestly, that was the more exciting bit. I know the Oscars is big and stuff, but I have to say we'd kind of gotten a little used to it. So, I mean, no big fuss about the Oscars. Yeah, what I was excited about was that Shah Rukh Khan was with Frida. And that was really exciting because at the end of the day, when you're an Indian, Shah Rukh Khan is like the biggest star around.
I completely agree with her, and he'll always be the Badshah.
Absolutely.
He was very, very, I know he was not at all nervous, but just to make me happy, he said, I'm also very nervous. Then, unfortunately, my Golden Globes gown was ripped at the back because I was walking and someone stepped on it and I continued walking. So it was completely ripped and I had to hold it in my hand. It was very uncomfortable, and he held it for me.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, he just said, I'll hold it for you so that you're not concentrating.
Like a train.
Yeah, he said, I'll hold it so you won't step on it and you're not concentrating on falling.
That is a lovely moment.
Yeah.
I want to ask you, does your family give you the starry treatment now when you come home?
No, they just behave very normally with me. Yeah, Sharon and I still fight sometimes. You know, she's like...
I think there's going to be a fight when you go home.
There is going to be. I mean, how dare she not enjoy the Oscars?
She still has to come home and take her own glass of water, fill her own plate of food. I mean, she's the same. And if she's not going to be Frida, who we always knew she was, we're going to bring her back to that. So, you know, she might as well not be the star at home.
Now I know why you're grounded.
Yeah.
Your family keeps you grounded.
True.
They let you be normal. They will not ever, you will never be the arrogant Frida. You will never be that superstar with her head in the clouds. Mm-hmm. You will always be Frida from Malad because they will make you Frida
true.
From Malad.
Very true.
You live alone.
I do.
You know, they say that joys are doubled when you share it and pain is halved when you share it. So who do you share your highs with today?
My sister.
But she's so far away.
Call her up or Skype or, you know, all the...
On Skype.
Being alone is in a way also not entirely the nicest place to be in, but you actually force yourself to deal with it as well. Mm. And you're not using someone else as your crutch all the time. Yes. Now I have to heal myself. Yes.
Frida's been nominated several times. She's on so many best dress lists and the most beautiful lists and all, along, especially on the Vogue list alongside Nicole Kidman, Keira Knightley, Scarlett Johansson, and so many more. In a short time, our Frida has become an international style icon, and that's a first from India. Did you always get interested in the fashion scene and clothes and
as a girl, stuff? Yes. As a girl, because I just loved flipping through fashion magazines and, you know, saying, oh, I like that dress, and I like circle it and say, I take the design to my tailor and say, mere liye bana do na, please bana do na, main fabric leke aungi, bana do. So it's just been like very normal in that sense, you know, to love fashion.
That's what Sharon told me.
Yeah. Frida was always fascinated with clothes and dressing up, and she knew how to, you know, give clothes a makeover and still use them. For example, one thing that she did, which fascinates me, is she took my dad's wedding pants. And I don't know how she managed to fit into dad's pants, but she did. And she made them A-lined pants. And she would wear that to college and look really cool in it. So, but for some strange reason, Frida loved my hand-me-downs. If I wore something, Frida would be like, I want what Sharon's wearing. And I'm like, you know what? You have so many beautiful things you keep getting all the while. Why are you eyeing my jewelry? It's like, just because I like to eye it. So I'm like, okay.
She doesn't know what I just stole her jewelry this morning and it's in my bag.
You did your BA at St. Xavier's.
I did. I just went back very, very recently. And it was such a euphoric experience entering college.
Yes.
So absolutely exciting. And some of the most carefree days of my life were in college.
But you must have also been hugely popular with the boys.
I wouldn't say I got a lot of attention, but I did get a little.
I would love listening to Frida's stories from college. Like, you know, we'd come back home and at night when we were in bed, I'd be like, so Frida, tell me about your day. And she's like, oh, you know, there's this guy who likes me and this guy who's good looking in college. She loves her slight flirting and she loves hanging out with the guys. So she's actually fun. You know, she likes her guy friends around her. She does not feel the need to restrict herself only to girlfriends. She likes to have her guy friends around her. So that's how Frida was. And you know what? At the end of the day, she got a lot of attention from the guys and she loved it. So why not bask in it?
I didn't bask in it. She's wrong. Again, we're gonna get into a fight tonight. I didn't bask in it.
Not fair.
No, come on. I was aware that there were these one or two or three boys who liked me, and every girl likes the attention. Come on, you like the attention when you're looked at and someone, you know, passes a very compliment.
Very much so.
Yeah, of course, we like it. But at the same time, I don't know. I mean, I couldn't let it go to my head.
But you don't have to defend this.
Okay.
At all. I mean, it's
totally
just goes...
wrong move. Not defending myself. I loved it.
That's right.
Absolutely loved it. Loved the boys at giving the attention.
Frida,
yeah.
So you imagined the career you wanted.
Right.
Did you also imagine the kind of guy you wanted?
He's only going to be in my fantasy.
Why are you so difficult?
Why am I so difficult is because I'm a fellow Libran and you'll completely understand me. We build these dreams
impossible dreams.
Impossible, absolutely impossible, you know. But having said that, I feel knowing that there is a reality, Dave is the perfect guy I'd imagine him to be. Yeah,
oh,
exactly what I'd imagine him to be. Yeah, and in fact, even better.
Here you have her, Frida the star, and now Frida the family girl. Come back and you'll see the fun side of Frida, another quality that makes her completely desirable. My mind.
baby, just give me a sign. And
Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena UltraShear. Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena UltraShear.
We've been waiting here for you, Frida and I, in our personality cafe. Truth bucket is, everybody in the audience have put their names, most of the people put their names into a bucket, which we call the truth bucket. Okay. And you'll pull out the name, and the lucky person will get to ask you any question that they want.
Perfect.
Okay?
Lovely.
And, oh, one more thing. If you don't answer the question, we want to avoid the question, you'll have to pay a penalty.
Okay.
Okay.
Be nice. Jitendra. Hello.
How are you, Frida?
I'm very good. Thank you very much. How are you?
I'm fine. Thank you very much. I've seen your Oscar-winning movie, and I know that you must have heard this a lot from many other people. But I personally feel that you've done an outstanding and a phenomenal job in that movie, and I feel personally feel that
you
should get an outstanding applause.
Then thank you.
Well, my question for you is, in life, if I were to strive for something.
If you were to strive.
If I were to strive for something, what should it be? Should it be money or should it be the fame?
Oh, that's kind of, it depends on what you really want. If you want the money, then you should go for it. But remember that that's not everything that there is to life. There's a lot of other things, like
exactly.
There's love and there's, and it's the same thing with fame. If you want just fame, those are the two. More money is very important, of course, because you need to live. But they're two more superficial things, if you understand what I mean, to strive for.
Okay.
I would say money and happiness and fame and happiness.
Okay.
Cheryl.
Hi. How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you.
Okay. After sitting through the entire show and like listening to you, I actually love you now.
Oh, like, thank you. I love you too.
It's like... If you have to ask someone out on a date, okay, is it only a man's prerogative?
Not at all.
Okay.
Trust me, a man finds it sexier when a woman goes up and says, listen, you know what, I think you're really cute and I think we should just go out on a date.
Okay.
Be direct. Be direct. Yeah. Karishma? Oh.
Okay, I just wanted to ask you, being a girl from Mumbai, have you ever fought with the rickshawwalas for the fare?
All the time.
Yes,
all the time. Because I feel it wasn't very, very too long ago. I think it must have been like 2 or 3 years ago. I think they do something to that meter of theirs, right? They do something. We should have a movement against it. But I mean, I do understand it's actually very easy for us to say, but they also kind of, you know, have to run a family and they have, you know, to fend for their livelihood. But it's so dishonest in a way, isn't it? When they twist, they do, so they tweak their meters and it goes up. And I'm like, listen, I travel from this place to this place every day and I know it doesn't come up to this much.
Yeah, that happens so many times.
I've had a terrible fight with the rickshawwala once and I was chased by a whole union. But
that's oh my God.
Story. Yeah, because I refused to pay up. So I'm like, I'm not paying you anything if you do this to me.
Thank you so
much. Vijay. Hi.
Hi, Latika.
Hello, Jamal.
My question is, what's a major difference between Bollywood and Hollywood?
I think one thing that is amazing about the international film industry is that time is money. So we don't waste a single moment. If there's a 9 a.m. call time, it's 9 a.m. you're on set. If you're not on set, then too bad, we're just not, you know, we're just going to give you a hard time for the rest of the day. But at the same time, I feel the love that you get in Bollywood, it's a bit more cold out there.
Machi, machi.
Shweta. Hello.
Hi. Actually, I've heard people speaking about you and Dev, so just wanted to ask, what did you think of Dev the first time you set an eye on him?
Oh my God. I was hoping we were not going to go there. Well, it's no secret to Dev and to the entire Slumdog team. But I walked into the room and there's this very tired young actor sitting over there waiting to audition me because he auditioned 15 of us for the second last audition. And he's sitting over there very, very tired. And I walk into this room feeling all womanly about myself. And I walk in and I'm like, I'm going to be a pedophile in this film because he is too young for me. And I walked out thinking, no. I don't think I can work with a kid. That's literally what I thought to myself. But when I met him, in a matter of minutes, it was all shattered because he was more mature than a 40-year-old.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. Good.
Hi.
Hi, Frida.
Hi.
Probably my question is going to be a little different than all of these people sitting out here.
Okay.
May I have a pleasure to dance with you?
Come on in. What are we going to dance on?
Salsa track, maybe?
Sure.
Felt insecure in front of another woman?
Yes.
Have you ever dated an American? Have you ever been on a blind date?
I have. Yeah.
Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena UltraShear.
Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena UltraShear.
Frida and I were waiting for you. Frida, have you ever played I Have Never Ever, Never Have I Ever, I Have Never?
Yeah, I've played a thing I Have Never Ever.
You have? It's a college game. All the college kids always play it, don't you guys?
It's a college game. Okay. It's a college game, but we need alcohol for that.
No. So we're going to play it our way, and okay. It's called Have You Ever?
Okay.
All right?
Mm.
Here we go. I will just put forward a question to you. If it is the truth, you'll have to hit the gong.
Oh, ah, okay.
That's right. And if it's not true,
okay,
you blow the horn. That's right. Have you ever felt insecure in front of another woman? Have you ever dated an American? How come?
I don't know. I think I was in a very Indian setting for such a long time, so I haven't really dated an American.
Okay. Have you ever been on a blind date?
I have. Yeah.
How did it turn out?
Oh, it was just that day and then never ever.
Have you ever lied in a television interview?
Yeah.
You want to tell us?
I don't even remember, but I know I have. I mean, I leave the interview, and I've not lied today, but I leave the interview and I think, I completely made that up.
Have you ever checked out the wanted jobs column?
On the internet? I subscribe to it. Like, let me know when there's a job availability. I have.
Okay. Have you ever fantasized about a girlfriend's boyfriend?
A girlfriend's boyfriend. Oh no, I don't go to that area.
Never.
No. Okay. That's a no-go for me.
Have you ever said, I love you, and not meant it? Yes.
I've done it. Yeah, I'm guilty of it.
Okay. That was lovely. Frida, tell me, did anybody ever predict the success that lay in store for you?
There was a Hindi compare, someone who compared in Hindi. He came up to me and he said, you mark my words, but in a couple of years, something so big is going to happen to you and you're not going to know what it is when it happens. And I was like, ah, yeah, whatever. So I feel I'm not completely ready, but I am curious enough.
Okay, let's just check it out.
Let's check it out. Yeah, let's check it out.
Let's bring on the tarot. Yay. To Manisha Khatwani.
Hello. How are you?
Frida Pinto. You're going to tell her what lies ahead.
And you're going to be sitting next to me for moral support.
I am going to sit next to you for moral support because I'm very curious myself.
Yes, of course.
Okay, here we go.
So, Frida, your birthday is 18th of October. So, you're ruled by Mars, which makes you very strong, independent, helps you in your career front, which would be fantastic. But I want to see what the cards have in store.
Okay.
So, I'd like you to just shuffle the cards a bit.
Okay.
Okay. Super. And I'm just going to need your hands to connect to you for a minute. Okay. And I want you to pull out 7 cards with your left hand. You like.
Okay.
4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. So these 7 cards give me a synopsis of your life. The first card she's got is the King of Wands, which means there's a man in her life, there's a relationship.
Okay.
But it's distant. Yeah. The King of Wands is somebody who keeps traveling and you keep traveling, as we already know.
Yeah.
The Chariot says work is the main priority at the moment.
Ooh.
Yes. And family duties. Yeah. You do a lot of your family duties very well, responsibilities, very attached to your family, as we know. And career success is there because of the High Priestess. Of course, because of your Mars, you do have some hidden enemies on the career front. So you have to be a little careful because you're very, you know, friendly and trusting and stuff. But not everybody might feel the same way. So you need to just be a little guarded on that front. Relationships, again, it's going to be, you've got the Knight of Swords. So you're very charged up. You're very much ready to work towards it. And you are seeing the effort from the other end as well. Do you want to know when marriage is in store?
Yes, I think Simiji wants to know. I think it's in 10 years. But
10 years. So let's see.
Okay.
Wow, it's not that far away.
Really?
It's
not like...
It's actually, your Prince of Coins says like in about 2 years, the relationship will be completely in a commitment level where you know where you're going. But marriage could take 3 to 4 years.
Okay.
You know?
Can you tell me what kind of a person she is?
Absolutely. She's got the Prince of Coins. Somebody who's independent, who's very intelligent, who's tall, who's famous. You'll never marry somebody who's not known.
We have an idea.
Yes.
I don't know. I mean, listen.
You and I have an idea.
I feel exposed.
Is it going to be a new person or it's an old
Which
want to know that?
No.
I think she'll know the person very strongly before she marries him.
What's that?
You'll know the person very strongly before you marry him.
That's really wonderful.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. So nice. Lovely. Thank you. Really wonderful. Thank you.
Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena UltraShear. Renault Fluence presents Simi Selects India's Most Desirable, co-presented by Neutrogena UltraShear.
Welcome back. I'm sitting with the most desirable, Frida Pinto, and this is still Personality Cafe.
Yay!
Frida, I know that your face is your fortune.
Is it?
For most stars, their face is their fortune. But sometimes the face can also be a fortune for less privileged people. I want to ask you a favor. For our charity, would you just reproduce the face of Frida Pinto so we can auction it on our site?
Okay, perfect. Okay? Does it have to be my face because I can't sketch myself or something that I feel represents me?
Well, as you see Frida Pinto.
Okay.
Own this masterpiece by Frida Pinto. I've never seen anything so amazing, so unusual. Please go to our site, www.starworld.in/IMD, and make a bid. The proceeds will go to charity, and this amazing piece will be yours forever.